O God, who is greater than the most powerful forces in this world, enable us to be still and know that you are God. O Lord, who answers out of the whirlwind of everyday life, breathe in us your Holy Spirit to strengthen, comfort, and guide us in the midst of the storms of life. O still small voice, speak to us that all we do may be in praise of your encompassing care. Amen. I like the way the Living Bible sets forth the relationship between the lawlessness, people running wild, and ignorance of God. Other translations help us to understand that the sage who coined the phrase was referring to the absence of moral vision and lack of prophetic insight. But I think the Living Bible calls it what it is, ignorance of God. The formula, then, implies that where the truth of God is known, society unfolds with dignity and justice, stability and purpose. And where there is ignorance of God, the people just seem to run wild. So here's my question. In a nation that has long claimed to know the truth of God, well enough at least to perpetuate the notion that its economy somehow put its trust in God, and whose unity was accomplished under God, and whose destiny was a reflection of the will or providence of God, why is it that in such a nation there is so much domestic violence, economic violence, religious violence, and ecological violence? Either the biblical formula doesn't work, or there is something drastically wrong with our knowledge of God. Could it be that the reason that people are running wild in all segments of our life as a nation is that what we thought was knowledge of God is in reality ignorance of God? At the heart of the problem is the Bible's claim that we were created in the image of God. Not just some of us, but all of us. Not some more than others. Not only those with good behavior. Not only those who profess certain beliefs. We all share somehow the image of God. Yet no two of us are alike. We are formed and informed by different cultures, and yet are part of the same image of God. We are the product of different sacred histories, yet all somehow bear witness to the image of God. Our tragic history, however, reveals that instead of discovering in our variety and uniqueness the image of divinity that God was unveiling in all of us, human beings created their own images of God, often in their own likeness, and deified them to the detriment of humankind. Most of the inhumanity that has been unleashed throughout history has been caused by people who claim to know the truth of God, by people who are determined to enforce the will of God, by people who feel destined to live out their version of the image of God. It was in the name of God that world cultures were desecrated and sacred histories were eradicated and ethnic peoples were exploited and enslaved until racial prejudice and religious bigotry and class warfare ravaged the landscape of life in the very nation that guaranteed to be safe havens for ethnic diversity and cultural variety and ecumenism. And it happened in large measure because those who claimed to know the image of God could no longer see the image of God in others, in all others. Yet one of the most exciting developments in our time is the growing awareness that we must re-examine our image of God before we can bear witness to others with authenticity and credibility. And we do this by asking ourselves certain questions which relate our knowledge of God to the other images of God who share the planet with us. Does my image of God encourage me to acknowledge with gratitude the ethnicity of others so that I may behold the image of God in them without prejudice? Does my image of God awaken in me a deep, a appreciation for the spiritual experience of others, so that I may rejoice with them in an experience of God that is different from my own? Does my image of God motivate me to respond to the needs of others without feeling superior or becoming condescending, so that I may behold in their needs the God whom I serve? Does my image of God challenge me to strive for win-win solutions for all who are in conflict, so that in experiences of mutuality and growth, we may all experience a more accurate awareness of the God who lives among us? Does my image of God allow me to see myself through the eyes of others, so that I may see how my image of God is complementing the image of God revealed in others? That kind of personal soul-searching is important because the image of God is somehow in our diversity, having more to do with variety than sameness, more to do with community than individuality, more to do with the vastness of truth than with singular notions of truth. And the more we allow ourselves to become caught up in the mystery which is God, the better the human family seems to get along. And without those inclusive experiences of God's truth, the people will continue to run wild. I'm reminded of the words to the song, One God. Millions of stars placed in the sky by one God. Millions of us lift up our eyes to one God. So many children calling to him by many a different name. One Father, loving all the same. Many the ways that all of us pray to one God. Many the paths winding their way to one God. Brothers and sisters, there were no strangers after his work was done. For your God and my God are one. In my seminary journey that led me to San Francisco Theological Seminary at that Southern California location, I met students from all over the United States and from all over the world. We were Chinese and Japanese. We were Ethiopian and Vietnamese. We were Korean and Dutch and German and Scandinavian and so much more. And in our fellowship times, many languages were spoken. And the great variety of Christian traditions were evident in the diverse worship services that were held over the years. But as we bonded as a student body, we experienced a spiritual awakening that we were together for the same reason. We had all experienced the Spirit of the living Christ. We all embraced each other as traveling companions on a spiritual journey. And we learned that our different cultures and languages were not an obstacle in our ability to communicate with each other. Spiritual awareness allowed one spirit to feel safe with another, to be encouraged by another, to celebrate the miracle of being alive together, and to discover life possibilities together. And at times, not a word in any language ever needed be spoken. As we worship together this morning, people in other cultures and religions are praying, all with different images of God, yet each somehow revealing the same God. And we are weaving together, by our prayers, the fundamental affirmations of human life that we all share. Because there is an undeniable relationship between the way we experience God and our capacity to live together. Jesus' ministry taught that loving neighbor and God were not two separate experiences, but one and the same. We could not have one without the other. He showed us the relationship between the miracle of human life and the majesty of creation. How a wildflower reflects the glory of God more authentically than all of Solomon's glory. He demonstrated by walking with his disciples how God accompanies us on all the paths of life. And by his miracles, he encouraged us to keep our eyes open to the miracles that are happening all around us every day. He could see the gratitude of God in every sunset and the promise of God in every sunrise. And by example, encouraged us to turn aside and find God in those temporal moments as well. Our calling is to allow God's power to work through us. We cannot define or determine how God's will is being accomplished. We can only trust that it is. We are spiritually connected by God's design to the human family, to the rest of creation, and to the very mystery of God. There is no greater experience in life than to feel spiritually connected to the very mystery of all that is divine and temporal. As we gather at the table this morning, let us understand that it was Jesus' way of dramatizing for all of humankind the family table in the kingdom of God. For gathered around it are all of God's children, in every land and from every age. The bread which we break reveals the brokenness that has come to the human family because of our ignorance of God. And the cup which Jesus shared dramatizes the way that we are all sustained in our mortality by the outpouring of the very Spirit of God. Come then to the table as the family of God gathers to celebrate its great diversity and infinite variety, knowing that in our communion with each other, we experience our most inclusive image of God. And I suspect that in our hallowed communion, God experiences the noblest image of all of us. Amen.